Hello, everyone! We are Geeks Not Nerds. I'm Captain Logan.
And I'm the Curious Lo.
And welcome the Curious Lo for her first time, for her first adventure in the world of Geeks Not Nerds. The Curious Lo, right, because a signpost up ahead, you have landed in the Twilight Zone. Lo has chosen our topic for today, and she's going to lay it on us, and we're going to talk about it for the next 25, 30 minutes. Lo, what would you like to talk about today?
So we are going to be talking about anachronisms in storytelling, and I mean purposeful anachronisms, not like they're using the wrong cell phone.
So you're talking about, like, intentionally when in a thing we take something from another era and we insert it intrusively into another period. So we're talking,
yes,
we're talking, it's got to be a period piece in the first place.
Exactly. Yeah, and I feel like that's honestly the only way it really could happen, because anything that's going to be, like, modern or taking place nowadays kind of can't have anachronisms.
Well, you wouldn't think, but the
now.
Yeah, but the only, and I've talked about this one a lot, the only exception to that I can think of is a really ambiguous historical setting.
True.
Where I don't know if you would even call it anachronistic when you're talking about a period of time that, like, sort of looks like present day, but we've, like, hodgepodged a bunch of stuff together. And, you know, like, 89 Batman is kind of that way. And,
yeah,
you know, anything that's, like, modern noirish, where we kind of back it off so it sort of looks like today, and if we want to, like, insert the internet and stuff, we can, but we can also get away with people not immediately bringing out cell phones or using the internet or whatever if we want our story to have to revolve around people using their own brains and stuff, and that's usually the reason you do it, to not have to deal with technology so much.
I was going to mention that as a form of anachronisms. So the TV trope for it, I don't know how much into TV tropes you are, but I'm obsessed with that website, and I'm always on it. But the TV trope for that is called anachronism stew, where you, like, just kind of throw a bunch of stuff together and, like, on purpose. The example that I had come up with was the kind of recent horror movie It Follows. They did a very purposeful thing. I don't know if you saw that movie, Kat.
I didn't know it was that way. That's cool.
It's so good. You should definitely see it. It's very artsy. But they did a very purposeful thing where they have these teenagers watching this old movie on a black and white TV at the same time that this girl is using, like, a shell-shaped e-reader. It's, like, this big. It's tiny. It's not something that exists nowadays, but she's using, like, an e-reader on top of all of this, like, 80s-style background music, and the fashion is sort of all over the place, and it's all very ethereal and dreamlike, and you're not supposed to be able to pin down when this is taking place, because that's not what the movie's about.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's more about this, like, metaphor for greater things and things like that, but that's a very interesting way to use anachronism, so that's, like, one method you can certainly use and make it this sort of, like, ethereal, this doesn't take place at any time type of thing.
I love that. That's,
yeah,
that's one of my favorite things, because you can, first of all, it's just, like, really stylistic and takes you completely out of the world that you that you're living in. So whether it's a thing that's supposed to make some sort of grandiose point or not, it kind of helps create an illusion where it's where it doesn't feel like you're in the real world at all. And I really like that kind of thing. I've seen it done badly. I've seen it done really inconsistently.
Mm-hmm.
Where you can, you know, at any point just, like, suddenly introduce a thing and be like, apparently, you know, this technology that seems too futuristic for this world exists, and we could have brought that out at any time. I don't know why nobody was using that before, you know, to solve a problem that it would have totally solved. So that's really, you have to be consistent with it. And it's harder, because you have to have, you know, a consistent set of rules, you know, that.
Yeah, for sure.
And but it helps make it escapist. That's the word I was looking for, escapist.
Yeah. I think a lot of times it ends up being used for, and this isn't the reason that I brought this up, but we'll get to that later.
Yeah.
It can be used in comedy. You see it a lot. I mean, you just look at, like, anything Monty Python, Robin Hood Men in Tights, you get these sort of, like, period comedy pieces. I mean, dare I say the trash that was Year One, just a lot of things where you get these kind of comedy pieces where they use that to be their humor. They're saying things that you shouldn't be saying in that time period, and they're doing things that don't exist, and like the Flintstones and things like that, where you have this very purposeful anachronism that is the joke.
Okay, like, okay,
oh,
I'm gonna...
in Flintstones you have like this technology that is a dinosaur, and...
I'm gonna fight you on Flintstones, though. I think you brought up two things that are very, very different, because when you have something like epic movie, or you know those and you mentioned Year One, those kinds of things, where it's used as kind of a crutch, where like it's funny because it's timely humor and the audience gets it, but the people from that time period shouldn't get it, but they do, so it's nonsensical, but not in a clever way. Rarely have I seen that done where that's really clever. Like, I think I brought this up before, when this topic has reared its head for whatever reason, but I tend to always bring up the genie in Aladdin.
Yeah, that's a good example.
Because the genie in Aladdin is constantly talking about, and it's because Robin Williams is making up everything off the top of his head, and he's in the time period he's in, so one of the devices he would use a lot would be going to kind of whatever was topical right then, because it was on the surface of his head, and when you're improvising, that's easier to go to, and so he would go to that stuff. And he was a comic genius, nothing against Robin Williams, but his genie was gonna be talking about stuff that just happened in 1992, 1990, and or things that were in recent memory. The genie almost got away with it, or maybe totally got away with it, because that's a being outside of time. That can like do anything,
yeah, he's
and he can
a character
create anything.
That has the power to know things that aren't within that time period.
And it's subtle. It's never discussed. You don't know why he's bringing that stuff up, but you would constantly have him say things, and then cut back to Aladdin, who has this totally oblivious facial expression. I don't know what the heck I'm talking about, and that kind of made it work. When it doesn't work is when you're telling a joke that's not even a joke, where it's just somebody said a thing that you've heard before, and it's supposed to be like a trigger word kind of joke. You know what I mean? And those are very often not very funny. Flintstones works.
Oh yeah, I wasn't like making a judgment on either of them being good or bad or whatever.
But Flintstones is a different.
Certainly works.
But it's a different thing because it's more consistent about it. Because what it does is it says, like, this is the premise of that, and I don't know if you're talking about the movie or just the cartoon show, but all of that, the premise of it, and it's exactly actually it and the Jetsons have the same thing going the opposite directions, right? Where the Jetsons is our world, but in the future, and with a little bit of. Like not in a hard way at all, but with like a little bit of commentary on like environment and stuff, where like all of the houses have to be built up into the sky because presumably you can't live on the ground anymore. But with both of those things, it's taking the time we live in and just extrapolating it all the way to the past or all the way to the future. And I think that is a case where it could be kind of fun and clever, because we are making some pop culture references, but we're putting them in a context. So you have like the movie did Sharon Stone, and I always thought that was really funny. It was too bad that she wasn't actually able to be played by Sharon Stone, who was what they wanted, who they wanted in the first place. But you see what I'm saying? So I don't know. I think that's a different example than the other thing.
Okay. Yeah. I can see how they are definitely different things, because you're right. One of them is using it more as like a crutch, and it's not even really a joke. It's just sort of, this is weird because it doesn't belong. Whereas they were quite clever with it on Flintstones and the Jetsons to kind of like make it was integrated into the world, and it was more than just, here's this silly thing that's happening that shouldn't be.
I mean, I'm not saying it's genius, but it was kind of fun and absurd and nonsensical.
Oh, and you know me, I love absurd stuff.
Yeah, me too.
I'm all about absurdity. All right, so this is the main reason. We haven't gotten to the reason that this is one of my favorite things that directors can do. It's totally an opinion. Like, I can see how some people would hate this. And it's using anachronisms to bring me into a period that I would not otherwise be able to relate to as well as I could. And I'm going to use my very favorite movie that I don't think I've talked about too much on Geekvolution yet, A Knight's Tale. This is my all-time favorite movie, and it's hotly contended. People do not like it, or they really love it. And in that movie, if you haven't seen it, they use like 70s and 80s rock for like all of the scenes. Like it's just 70s rock all through this like medieval jousting movie. And you get like, you get fashion that doesn't belong in this movie, and you get like slang that doesn't belong. I mean, you have Alan Tudyk famously, I think probably the most famous line from this movie is him going, "It's called a lance, hello." And like, you know, that sort of slang that you get in there. There's a ballroom scene to Golden Years by David Bowie. It's a very conscious decision to create this sort of sports movie that you're being transported back to. Even though it takes place in a different time, you still have these kind of like young 20-something guys like trying to make it, and it's the underdog story. So we've got the rock montage, and we've got the lady that we're trying to woo, and it's very much like, here's Rocky, but it's jousting, and they do this very consciously. And I love that, and they've done it in a lot of my favorite movies. I mean, Moulin Rouge does it, the newest Great Gatsby does it, Marie Antoinette, that came out in like 2008 does it. A TV show called Rain is another really great example of the music and the fashion. And I love, it seems like it's always surrounding kind of teenagers or young people, because I think a lot of times it ends up being this sort of, hey, audience that maybe doesn't know anything about this time period, like come along with me. I'm gonna treat you okay as a director, and I'm gonna make these people say these slang words that you know. And I'm gonna make these people, you know, be doing these things that, even if a lot, like in the case of Marie Antoinette, a lot of that movie is very historically accurate. I mean, it was filmed at Versailles, they're wearing period costumes, but then you also have a scene where she's eating a ton of like food and cake and stuff, and it's set to the song I Want Candy. And so you're immediately transported to this, like, yes, I know exactly who Marie Antoinette is supposed to be, even if she still talks in a manner that is very fitting of the time period, kind of what you assume that would sound like. There's an airplane going.
There's an airplane.
this is what I normally cut out. But it for me, I always love seeing that sort of stuff, because it really, I think that it's a clever way to bring me into something. That's not to say that I can't watch something that takes place in a different time period and not understand what's going on. I don't think that it's necessarily a, like, you aren't smart if you need this sort of a thing to draw you into a movie, but I think it's another kind of artistic choice to draw people in and get you into a certain mindset quickly. I mean, it's kind of like you're cheating and being like, ooh, come with me really quickly, and you already know what sort of movie you're getting yourself into, but it also leaves that movie open to tell you other things that it would otherwise have to set up without this really quick and easy. They're using this type of slang, so you know what type of people they are. That was very long-winded.
No, that's okay. I'm of two minds about that, and I think it's a, and this is my cop-out, and I always go to this, but I think this really is the case with this, I think, that it's a case-by-case thing. Is it handled with care? Is there a reason for it? Is it there just for the novelty and the sensationalism of it, or are we creating a context where we're making a thing fresh again by setting it in a period, and maybe even, as you say, sometimes being pretty historically or period accurate about a thing, or as much as you can expect, but then with this mindset of the audience this is for is a 20th or a 21st century audience.
Exactly.
And I say I'm of two minds about it because I think you're right. I think a lot of the reason that's often done is to try to appeal to audiences that wouldn't otherwise watch those things, and so that might be the initial motivation, but then that can be a juxtaposition that creates this artistry that you wouldn't otherwise have, so it doesn't end up actually feeling like a really dumbed down thing. It can create maybe even another thematic layer or an artistic or some other sort of layer.
Oh yeah, and I mean, I'd already mentioned Marie Antoinette a couple of times just because it's a really great example. I mentioned that they use I Want Candy and a couple other of that sort of like 80s, 90s kind of pop music.
Yeah.
And at the same time, they also were doing a lot of music that is like classical, like pianoforte, harpsichord music that would have been extremely period accurate. And it sort of shows you the two different sides of what this historical figure was going through as she was trying to rule a country and was only 14 when she was crowned. And, like, she's growing up as a teenager. She's a teen. She doesn't know how to run a country. So it's sort of this, like, when she's having to be the queen, it's all very, you know, it's Versailles, too, which I don't know how much you know about French court, but it was crazy. So she's having to do all of these things that she wouldn't normally have had to do, and that's all very, like, stifling. And then when she's allowed to do what she wants, it ends up being a lot more like rock concert, and it gives you that juxtaposition, and that's like,
interesting.
One way to sort of get into that.
I have to watch that
but
at some point.
That's not the only way to do it.
I have to watch that at some point to see if I have the same experience with it you did, or take it the same way.
It's a Sofia Coppola movie who is, like, I love her, and I know a lot of people do not.
Yeah.
So it's certainly something that you might not like at all.
Yeah, but I'm curious about it now that now you've been talking about it, because that sounds like kind of maybe the modern example of this. There's a lot of directors that do these sorts of things. I think that it's Tarantino tends to go there. Where when he does kind of period pieces, and of course his stuff is often really heightened and not period accurate on purpose.
It's like almost alternate universe or like alternate history, but like just barely.
And we'll deal with a lot of the ideas that you would deal with there, but he's exaggerating everything, and importantly, the rock music or the metal or whatever it is that he's using or in other sorts of movies like this, importantly, that's not from the protagonist's perspective, that's from Tarantino's perspective. I think the operative word here is interpretation. You're getting it through the lens of the artist, and so it's almost like, I don't want to say unreliable narrator, but it's like the people, this is when it works, I think. I think it can be really intrusive, even in this context sometimes, where, you know, what you were describing with, like, I Want Candy and stuff, I could see that being absolutely obnoxious. I don't know, I would have to look at it. But I can't think of a good example. I have seen things like that before where I'm like, I don't think this is really adding anything. I don't think that, it's, like, I get the... And we've done entire videos about this, using popular music to score a scene instead of actual score. And Vince always liked to complain about the rock track with the lyrics that seemed to be narrating the scene that you were watching as it was unfolding. Where it's like, where you, sometimes it almost feels, and you get this on a lot of TV shows now, and especially TV shows geared toward teenagers, and it'll be a thing that's there to kind of like try to artificially swell your emotion in a way when it's using that as a crutch because the writing's not good enough, you know? Like, we can't just have a scene where you really care about these two characters on screen, you know, like a romantic sort of scene. We need the thing in the background that's scoring it that tells you, and this can be done even just with really sappy violins. I'm not saying that it's always just rock music, but sometimes you have it where it's almost as if you have a lyricist where you have a person singing that's like these two people really like each other, but they won't say what they're feeling right now. And like, I've seen these scenes that can be really annoying, and I think that can happen with like the historical juxtaposition thing also, but I think getting older things specifically and obviously through a modern lens can be really interesting. And it has to be tasteful, and it has to be clear that they're not saying this is the way it was. You know what I mean? It can't, unless it's a farce, unless it's a comedy, you can't just randomly have rock music playing without understanding why it's there.
In Marie Antoinette, it's certainly not a comedy. It's not a comedic movie. It's definitely more of an artistic choice. But with A Knight's Tale, which was another one that I brought up as doing this, it is more of a comedy. It's not like Monty Python comedy, but it certainly has more of a plot than that. But it definitely has kind of, it's like a dramedy, I guess, like a sports movie. It's a sports movie is what it is. I mean, you've seen it before, the underdog sports movie, where it's this person that shouldn't be able to win, and like there's the drama in there, but there's also like the funky sidekick character who has all of his one-liners. It just happens to take place in like the 13th century, and is about jousting instead of soccer. So it's more of a comedy than Marie Antoinette is, so it is a slight difference, but I think it works in both movies for that, for those examples.
How do you feel about the, and we have a number of these now, how do you feel about the modern setting Shakespeare play?
Because
that is such a popular choice now, and I've seen it both on film and on stage now.
I know that Orlando Bloom did a version on Broadway that was like completely, completely modern.
And of what?
Romeo and Juliet. I think I remember seeing him do an interview of it, and I was like, "Huh? So is it like they're adapting? Like, are they doing it very much like the Leonardo DiCaprio
version
in the 90s, or like was it a different one?
That opens with the explosion of a gas station."
I really love that movie.
I do too. I can't decide even now if that's a guilty pleasure or if it really is good. I don't know.
I really love Shakespeare, and I think just having another version that is very different than all of the other amazing versions of Romeo and Juliet is fun, because I can see another version that's period accurate and looks, and it just happens to have different actors and actresses. And actually, a couple of years ago, there was another version of Romeo and Juliet that came out that starred, I think, Hailee Steinfeld? Is that her last name? Steinfeld? Something like that.
I don't know who that is.
And they added, I was so mad, this is getting off track a little bit.
No, that's right.
They added scenes that aren't in, like, it was an actual, like, they're doing the script, and then there's, like, scenes in it that aren't from the original Shakespeare, and
that's,
I was like,
bizarre.
What is happening? This is weird. You, if you want to do a different story, or, like an adaptation of it that isn't the Shakespeare, do a West Side Story sort of take. Like, you don't have to add weird scenes.
That's why we have The Lion King.
Exactly.
Yeah, ooh, boy, that's really weird. Yeah, I'm trying to remember. I saw a really good modern take on the stage once, and I can't remember. It wasn't Much Ado About Nothing. What was it?
Was that the one that they did
remember.
The movie, who did it? I want to say it's like a huge director did a modern version.
Well, yeah,
of, like,
Whedon did Much Ado a couple of years ago.
Yes.
I haven't seen that yet.
Seeing it on Netflix.
Yeah. No, I haven't watched that yet either. I really need to do that. And he did his like in black and white, and he shot the entire thing in his house. And
But it's also modern, so like that's a weird decision to make it like modern but in black and white and like different things like that.
Yeah,
that
that's a really that's a really good point. But I mean, that is, you know, dictionary definition of anachronism, where you're having everyone. I mean, you're basically transporting a group of people from a particular time period into our time period, and somehow or other they didn't notice. Like, that's pretty much what it is. Where they're talking like they're in the Shakespeare play, and like they're in the 15th century, 16th century, and then, but they're doing all the normal everyday things that you and I would be doing. I've never known what to make of that. It's jarring in a cool way sometimes, where it's just like, it can be really, you can feel really stylistic and heightened and weird, but kind of consistent. But honestly, I think the main reason we do that is so that kids know what the heck they're looking at. Where like, they can figure out more things in context of what's being said in the dialogue, because they at least are familiar with the surroundings. And
well, I mean,
I
it's that stereotype of, like, an English teacher rapping Shakespeare so that it's
that's
cool
great.
And you understand it.
Yeah.
But it works. I mean, like, there's a reason it's a stereotype, is because sometimes, especially teenagers, no offense to any teenagers that are watching, but, like, the stereotype being that not all teenagers care about this time period or these type of characters or whatever, and that's a way to, like, get through to your audience, sort of like what I was talking about earlier. Doesn't always work by
any means. And
your white English teacher is super awkward when he's rapping and he needs to stop right now. It's just making you feel awkward. But sometimes they're really good at it and it does work. And I think that that is a good metaphor.
That's wonderful. What's problematic about it is that a lot of the time when you try to make a thing like that fun, you're saying that it's not cool as it is. And
true. Yeah.
If you can get and this is the tough part, of course, but if you can get kids over the hump of it's older English and you're not going to be familiar with some of the vocabulary, Shakespeare plays, most of them, really good stories, really cool,
very violent.
why can't you come at it with from that place of well, there's intrigue and there's death and there, you know, like all of the things that make for great stories. If I were teaching Shakespeare, I would go to the things that I know you love that you would not have without Shakespeare, and I would show you how things that you think are original are regurgitations of better things. And like, I totally understand why it's difficult, you know, how it's difficult to get kids into that, you know, older thing sometimes. But the problem is, if you try to say rap Shakespeare to get people into it, are they actually latching onto it because of the substance, or is it just because you were rapping? And that's the question I have sometimes with taking an older thing and having people speak like they did, but just putting it in a modern context. Is that actually helping us understand the meat of it more, or is it you're just relieved because you don't have to look at people in period clothes doing boring things? And again, it's a case by case sort of thing, because the DiCaprio film I thought was really fascinating. And again, there are other there are actually several of these, and I'm not thinking of the other ones besides Much Ado. But I'm trying to remember, there was another one. Was it?
I could think of lots of like adaptations of
Shakespeare
plays that are in modern settings, but typically they don't.
What was the one that Keanu? What was the one that Keanu Reeves was in?
Oh, I don't know.
Can you look that up real quick?
Yeah,
I was because that was one that didn't quite work, and I think I don't even remember if it was
Much
a modern.
Ado About Nothing.
Was it another Much Ado? Yeah.
But it doesn't look modern.
It wasn't
to me.
Well, now that you say that, it wasn't. Yeah, it's just been a long time since I've seen that. Yeah. I shouldn't have brought that up because I'm not prepared to talk about that. It's been years since I've watched any of those.
I've never seen it.
But here's where I find myself on, like I'm of two minds about this too. I'm very unsure of myself on this topic, apparently, today, Lo. I'm very indecisive today, Lo, where this is one of those things where, on one side, I think that it's kind of a crutch, and on the other side, I needed to see some Shakespeare on stage or in a movie to really appreciate it, because it's meant to be performed in the first place.
Oh, yeah, I mean, like, that is one thing about Shakespeare that I think is part of why you get that stereotype of a teacher rapping it in order to make it interesting, is because reading a play is very different than reading a book or an actual narrative, because you don't necessarily get all of the stuff that you would with a book, because there's not as many descriptions, and the ones that are there are just like bland stage directions that don't bring you into the story. And so it is like a weird one with Shakespeare specifically, or just with any play.
Yeah.
Because it is a different medium, and it's not exactly the same as just reading any old book.
Sometimes just good delivery from someone that understands the material will help you understand it with the context, but then that's also somebody else's or a group of people's interpretation of the work. Mm-hmm. And with something that is meant to be performed, it's impossible to not have to some degree other people's interpretation of it.
Yeah, well, and I didn't want to bring this up too much, because I don't want to make it seem like this is the only thing I ever talk about recently, especially if you follow me on Twitter, but we keep getting closer and closer to it, and I don't think we can dance around it any longer. There is the new Broadway show Hamilton that is about a historical figure that is performed literally. It is a rap and hip-hop musical. They specifically took this historical, kind of stereotypical, like boring founding father thing and made it this rap musical. And I will defend that musical to my grave as far as how important and how interested it can make people, specifically young people who maybe haven't been very interested in history in the past, interested in it now. And I know that it affected me that way. I've never been interested in American history, and I've already read two different books on it that obviously aren't rap books. You know, I was introduced because of this sort of anachronistic telling of this founding father's life, and now I'm super interested in the American Revolution, and I never cared before. So it can work. It's just all about, it is, it's such a weird, like, case-by-case thing.
Okay, but I want to suggest that the musical is a different ballgame.
It is. It is very different. I mean, there's a difference between performing already written words.
Well, that's not what I mean.
In a different context.
Yeah, but here's the thing. There's already a weird performance conceit in a musical that you don't have in a straight-up movie that's supposed to be... you've got people in a room with a camera that's like a fly on the wall. And
yes.
So the anachronism there when you have period, when you have current music in a period thing is we're hearing something that the people don't know there that is supposed to appeal to something that would, that we would understand and recognize and latch onto that they wouldn't. The musical, I would argue, has always had this.
Oh, for sure. I mean, you look at Phantom of the Opera and they've got electric guitar
throughout the entire thing. Yes, yeah. Like, just because it's rap and that's just a modern version of this. You take the basic, like, Broadway music, still a 20th century invention. If you take a play that's set in let's say you had this, I don't know if this was a thing. Let's say you did a musical version of The Crucible.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever music was in that was in that play would not sound like anything the people would actually be listening to or performing in the 19th, what is it, Crucible, 18th, 19th century.
I want to say it was like the early 19th century.
I think so. Yeah.
Maybe it was earlier than that.
I think
that.
So.
Remember
it's been
like mid-1700s?
It's been a while since I've read that. It's been a while since I've, now I feel like an idiot. That's based on a Salem witch trials. No, that's 18 something.
Is it 18? Okay.
Isn't it? Now I feel dumb. It's been a while since I've had to study that. Lo and I are having to reach into the bowels of our earlier education. But the musical already has this weird conceit of people are suddenly bursting into song.
And it takes place from 1692 to 1693. We were way off.
Okay. Now I feel dumb. But
I was in The Crucible in high school. I should know this.
Yeah. But the musical already has this weird conceit of people breaking into song that people don't do. And so how hard are you going to nitpick this? At what point are you going to, like, are you really going to say that the people suddenly bursting out in a song in a musical need to be singing period accurate music?
Okay, well, here's something just to... Maybe make you change your mind a little bit. Hamilton also, not only is it using music that is anachronistic, but like you said, pretty much any musical is kind of by definition using music that wouldn't be period accurate for anything. They purposefully,
and again,
I guess
it's already
anachronistic and just not historically accurate. They cast people that are not of the same nationality or race as the founding fathers. Most of the people in this play are like Latino and Black and Asian and like all these other things, like on purpose. Like it was a very conscious decision to do that, to make it more modern.
Yeah. And I don't know whether to criticize that or not, especially not having seen it. Especially without seeing it. Because something,
well, something.
It depends on
if we want to get away from the music.
No, not at all. But I just want to say this: it depends on intent, right? Because at that point, and stage plays kind of already have this a lot. Not all of them, but a lot of stage plays start to feel kind of meta, where like the characters are almost aware that there is an audience, and so when you so if you do that, if you have like a lot of modern music. And you have that different ethnicities than it possibly could have been of the. And I've seen a lot of plays that are that way, where we just cast the person that's right for it because sometimes just simply we don't have a big enough pool of people that look like the people that would have been there. But if they do it really consciously, at that point, it's almost this meta thing of, you know, from the beginning to the end that, you're supposed to be keeping in mind that what you're looking at is a modern interpretation and that you're looking at actors. So, like, you would want to a degree, get sucked into the fiction that is based on reality, but that also... everyone there, the actors, the audience, is aware that they're part of this experience where they are recreating a thing. Almost like a Civil War reenactment or something.
Yeah, that's actually a really good way to put it. One thing just kind of about that, like, casting people that aren't necessarily of the same, like, ethnicity or whatever.
Yeah.
In Marie Antoinette, just to bring it back around to one that I've mentioned multiple times, Kirsten Dunst is in that movie and she plays Marie Antoinette, and they on purpose do not have her do a French or a British accent. Every actor that's in that play uses their own accent. They have American, British, and French actors and actresses that are all using their own accents, and they specifically just didn't even try to deal with it. Like, they're just like, everything else is very period accurate, and a lot of the people that are at the French court are French, but, like, her mom speaks with a British accent, and, like, her brother, I think, speaks with an American accent, even though he lives in, like, a different country, and I feel like I remember them saying that the reason they did that was because they wanted her to feel like an outsider, because she's from Austria, which was a very different country than France, but that's sort of that same thing, but instead of being in a stage play, you have it in a movie where they are on purpose doing something that would not have been the case.
Yeah, and I think the lines between, you know, stage and screen get weirdly blurred. I mean, I'm just saying that, like, when you take a thing that was a play and you make it into a movie, like at what point does it stop being a play and now it's an adaptation onto film? Because we've all seen movies that are based on plays that feel like a stage play, even if we got them off the stage and we built sets. And we've seen the like, very, like, drastic reinterpretation, or not even reinterpretation, but where it's as much of an adaptation from play to screen as it would be from book to movie. So, like sometimes you'll have some of the same decisions made just because that's how we did it on the stage, and then, again, you have to just kind of leave it up to each person to decide if that's a, you know, a good thing or not. This will be my final thought. I think it's just, like, with so many things, a matter of communication. Either it should be really clear why it's done, or it should be really clear that, at the very least, it's supposed to be exaggerated and heightened and not accurate, not the way it was, and that we're not saying that, you know, we're not making a documentary. We're not saying that this is historically the way it was, and that if we can't make it clear, like, any particular, like, really particular reason we did it, I mean, because sometimes things just look like artsy fartsy, you know what I mean? Kind of like when you read something that just reads too writerly, where you're like, it sounds like a teacher told you to do that. You know what I mean? Like you're trying to impress people as opposed to having, like, a real concrete reason that it's done that way that, like, enhances the piece in any way. If you want to leave it up to an audience's interpretation, that can work. It can be really risky. It can be really dangerous. Sometimes the thing will just completely fall apart where it looks like we just threw a bunch of random elements into a thing and hoped that the art theaters would show it. And if the art theater showed it, then people would say it was brilliant. And we've all seen those movies. So, yeah, I don't know. I mean, like, honestly, I don't fall anywhere until I see it. Like I have to see that particular movie before I can make a case for or against it. I mean, I think it can be wonderful. I'll mention Watchmen, because I have to bring up Watchmen in every video I can think of. Watchmen's a thing that doesn't exactly have this, but it sort of does. Where
it's like ambiguous about when it's supposed to be taking
place. No, not at all. No, you know exactly when Watchmen takes place. Watchmen takes place in 1985.
Yeah, I just mean with, like, you know when it's supposed to be taking place, but I feel like the visual style and, like, stuff.
Yeah, I bring up Watchmen specifically because of music. Watchmen, because here's the thing, it's an alternate history. Nixon's been elected 4 times. It's an alternate history. And it does look like the 80s, but it's this super stylized thing because the comics look that way. And it's supposed to be this kind of unreality. Like, Vietnam is our 51st state. It's a different world we're living in. And you have, you know, superpowers are possible and stuff. So it's this weird, grand, higher, you know, looking thing. But curiously, some of the music that's in that movie, because it is scored primarily with popular music and with a lot of rock and stuff, and some of it is either 80s music or stuff that happened before, and some of it I think is not, although I'm not completely positive if there's anything that was written after 1985 that's in that movie, but, like, I'm using this as an example just to say that, like, is it okay to take a thing like that where, like, you're trying to make it feel like the 80s, but it's also an alternate history. You take a thing that's kind of alternate history, and you put in some music from that period. Does it all have to be that way? At what point is that a problem? Like if one song came out this year, I'm not saying Watchmen did this, I'm just saying like a thing like that, if one song came out this year and is there because it seems to fit with that scene for whatever reason, like thematically or just mood, like is that okay? Or like is it inconsistent now? I don't know. I mean, I think this is a hard thing to call a lot of the time.
Oh yeah, and like I never wanted to say anything about like it is good or it is bad. It's just a very interesting stylistic and artistic choice, I think, mostly by certain directors. And certain directors tend to do it a lot. Like The Great Gatsby, Moulin Rouge, and Romeo and Juliet are all Baz Luhrmann.
Does Gatsby do it? Because I didn't see that.
And he does that in his movies consistently. It is like an artistic choice that he does. It is very much his style to put in modern music and like things like that. And it works for him, in my opinion. I like all three of those movies immensely. I think they're all brilliant. But I can see how something like that would be a major turnoff and would not endear somebody to a movie, that it would just bother them and they wouldn't get it. And they're like, no, this isn't how it would be happening. And I get that. And I'm not like, I don't even, you know, one way or the other. I think it's all kind of like your own personal, what works for you and what doesn't. And it's a weird topic.
No, it
is.
I
wanted to bring it up.
It's definitely a taste thing much of the time. And it's, because like, I think whether or not that's gimmicky can be a really subjective thing. And whether or not
I'm sure
it gets in the way of your enjoyment
all
of the
three
thing.
Of those movies that I mentioned as extremely gimmicky, because they are all very much the same and they did it in the trailers. Like, it is definitely a way that they got people into the theater.
Yeah.
Specifically with Great Gatsby, because that one, like, he'd already done Romeo and Juliet and Moulin Rouge at that point, so people knew what they were getting themselves into, yet they still have like Beyonce in the trailer for The Great Gatsby.
Yeah.
Which is very interesting, but it was like Beyonce sung by Beyonce in the style of like this like roaring 20s like kind of flash music, which is just all sorts of weird and very interesting, if nothing else.
A lot of melting pot stuff.
Yeah.
That happens in film, and I think sometimes that's kind of intentionally, otherwise, sort of a reflection of our culture, where we keep taking things that we love and either regurgitating them or trying to make them fresh again, and obviously, and I've talked about this a lot, this is a thing that, this is what art is to a degree, right? Is you build on things that have been done before, that have been done before. But when you take like a specific property or a specific like play or a book or something, and you adapt it again, and the way you try to make it fresh again sometimes is to blend it with like a bunch of other things and hope it comes out as something that feels really original and distinct. And
yeah.
I don't know how you can be sure that's going to work. And for whom that's going to work.
It just depends on the movie or the TV show or what have you.
I don't feel real qualified on this one. This feels like a thing that requires further study, and now I want to further study this because it's a really interesting
one. You have a bunch of movies that I just suggested to you that you can go watch. I know for me, this is something that will extremely endear me to a movie kind of right off the bat. I think part of it is because I am a huge fan of music.
Yeah.
And music really does things for me as far as, like you were sort of mentioning it in a negative way, and I definitely agree with you that it can be negative where, like, you know, they're playing this sappy song about exactly what's happening. But there are moments when, like, music just gets to me. I'm the type of person that when I'm depressed, I have to put in, like, a, you know, depressing album and, like, listen to it and work through my emotions. But that like, works for me. Like, I'm a sucker for a good trailer with awesome music.
Oh, yeah,
not that it
me
always
too.
Works necessarily. Like, I didn't love the new Star Trek trailer. I thought that didn't fit because it's Star Trek and that just doesn't fit with that. But I loved it with Suicide Squad. Like, immediately I was like, yes, Ballroom Blitz. I love this song. I'm there with you. I love all the stuff that they did with it. And I can see how for other people that is just like, oh, this is like a cop out and they're just trying to get us because it's a popular song and that's what we do now. So yeah, it's totally just a thing that for some reason speaks to me for whatever reason. So when you put modern music in like a different time period, I'm like, ooh, this is interesting and cool and you got me. And I don't know, I'm the audience for that, I guess.
Well, I think it's designed to create a feeling of familiarity in a thing that otherwise might not have any.
Or like nostalgia in a thing that you wouldn't get
and
in.
And that is the name of the game in Hollywood these days.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. Nostalgia is everywhere. That's like everybody's favorite thing.
Yeah. And as I said, you know, we so often are repackaging things, and that can be a good thing and it can be a bad thing. But I think a lot of that is trying to make people feel welcome in a thing that they're not otherwise sure if it's even for them and if they even should be there. And again, sometimes I think that's a crutch, and sometimes it's not. Just depends. Let's go ahead and move on now to rants, and Lo is going to give her very first rant on Geeks Not Nerds. Lo, what will you be ranting about today?
Well, I need to preface this with, I am not a very generally angry person, and I was stressing about trying to come up with something.
For the record, neither am I.
I know, but you've been doing this for a while, so Probably when you think of something, you're like, ooh, I'm going to save that for a rant.
I mean, I get real passionate and critical, and I look angry when I'm not. That is a thing about me, is that I've had that before where people are like, Kendall, how do you get so worked up about this? I'm like, well, because I'm like making a video that's supposed to be entertaining. You know what I mean? So like, yeah. But also, I'm just deeply passionate about like everything that I'm talking. Like I always get really, so it's not worked up so much as just like energy. But yeah. So like, I'm not angry, Lo.
Okay. But just like worked up about stuff. That doesn't happen to me often, unless it's for like really silly things.
Lo was saying nothing bothers her.
Like
nothing.
Social issues, which is not something I want to rant about on here.
I appreciate that. Yeah, nothing bothers Lo is what she's saying. She's just...
No, I'm just saying that what I'm about to rant about, everyone has probably ranted about before.
Oh, well, make it awesome and then it's fine.
Okay.
Make it your own. Do like the anachronistic movies with songs that don't. You just gotta make it your own, Lo. Yeah, you gotta reinvent it somehow.
All right. So what I'm going to be ranting.
Put on a hat.
And this specifically is happening in a couple of TV shows that I used to really really like, and it's that TV shows, specifically American network television, goes on so long, like long after they should have just cut it and been like, okay, we have run our course, so that you get to the point where everybody knows that I'm a huge fan of Supernatural. Even though I still really like the show, it is completely changed, and I think they should have ended it years ago. An even better example of this is another show that I don't think many people who come to this channel watch, but who knows, The Vampire Diaries. They have lost their main character. There's rumors that another, like, secondary character is going to be leaving, and it just got renewed for another season, and I just don't get it, because you're changing your characters and you're going way past what the original intent of the show was and just continuing because the show seems to be doing good, and it just seems like people on network television don't care that their, like, show is not necessarily getting well received anymore, and they don't care about making something that will stand the test of time, because God knows you're not going to go back and watch this show that makes no sense because 11 seasons long and it changed 800 times. There we go. I feel much better now.
Good job. Yeah, this is a thing we could do a whole show on.
Yeah, it's a big topic.
I don't think we've done a show on this, but it's certainly a thing I've brought up a million times. And obviously, my go-to example is Smallville. And Smallville is a show that went on for 10 seasons. And, you know, you're talking about changing premise. It was still called Smallville, and about half its run doesn't take place there.
Yeah.
I mean, that's crazy. That at one point would have been seen as an absurd thing that no one would think to do. And it's like an accepted thing that has happened now. It's that kind of thing cracks me up and is absolutely hilarious. Yeah. What you're talking about is getting past the point where we're where the story is told and done, or the story was at some point we got away from the story and we never found it again. You know, that's a thing that happens with that as well.
And we were sort of mentioning this, I think, before we started recording, and this just kind of popped up in my head, but Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., like, we were talking about how it's, like, gotten away from, it's not even, S.H.I.E.L.D. doesn't exist anymore. How is it Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.? S.H.I.E.L.D. was dissolved in season one.
What
is happening?
I feel like the premise for that show was tanked by the second half of its first season.
Yeah, with Winter Soldier, you don't have S.H.I.E.L.D. anymore. So, it's Agents of Nothing.
I mean, I like the idea of Coulson maybe restarting S.H.I.E.L.D. if it's going to actually be S.H.I.E.L.D. But, like, you know, if you just watch the movies, it's not even S.H.I.E.L.D. anymore.
Yeah.
But, I don't know if you watched Dexter, but Dexter had this problem. And what's interesting about a thing like that, too, is that that's a show that is certainly not just an episodic procedural thing and has, from the very beginning, season-long arcs. But it feels, by and large, like each season is kind of a new story. And so it's a thing like that is even weirder because it's not like the story was completely told and finished where it's like, you know, we had like 4 or 5 years. Like, imagine if Breaking Bad had kept going. Like,
I was just going to say, Breaking Bad is almost like the antithesis of this, that, like, they knew what they wanted to do, and they did the amount of seasons that they wanted to, and it was very clearly plotted, and they ended, and it was brilliant.
Yeah, I mean, apparently
they didn't get forced to do more.
I mean, you Lost was sort of this way. It didn't quite work out, but, you know, that was a thing that it could have gone forever, and I think it was still maybe 2 seasons longer than it should have been, or at the very least, its season should have been shorter seasons from the beginning. Although I feel dirty saying that, considering how much I love the first season. Maybe everything passed.
Oh yeah,
because season 3 is one of the most boring seasons of television I've ever seen of anything. It just goes
on and on. Talked about this before, but season 3 is my favorite season.
You're
of
wrong.
Show.
You're just wrong. There's only so much of Kate and Sawyer in cages that I can deal with. It's just like, get out of the cages. You clearly only have 13 episodes of story to tell or less. Stop it. But you get things like that where I think part of the reason that this happens is because networks are still trapped in a headspace that they were in 30 years ago, where series, by and large, were episodic, and premises were created that could go on ad nauseum if a show was popular enough. So, like, there's no reason Twilight Zone couldn't have been on for 30 years. In a way, there's no reason that Star Trek or Dukes of Hazzard or you know Matlock or like these are all concepts where your basic premise, like, you might sometimes build on things, you might bring characters, recurring characters back sometimes, but by and large, it's this guy's a lawyer who solves crimes, or this is a starship captain who goes out and finds new planets and new civilizations, and like, you can keep making that over and over again. But when you have a thing,
it's something you can come into when you haven't seen any other episodes, or you haven't seen an episode in 2 years, but it's all still the same characters, and they all still act pretty much the same, and you can just go in and understand what's happening, even though you haven't seen anything for 2 seasons. Nowadays, you'd be completely lost.
The only way you ruin that is if you get burnt out and you run out of ideas. I mean, that's how you ruin that. But then you get other things where it's a thing that obviously should have been a story that had a beginning, a middle, and an end. I think some shows can't decide which of those they are. And I think Gotham is a perfect example. Gotham has no idea what kind of a show it is. And I mean, we've talked about that a lot on the channel, and that is a fascinating study. But, like, does that want to be a story with an end? Honestly, at this point, I don't think so. I think Gotham wants to be on for 15 years. I really do, and I think it is designed to make you an insane person. Anyway,
it wants to put us all in Arkham. It's Doctor Strange's Hugo Strange's like ultimate plan.
Are you still watching that show?
Yeah.
I can't stop watching it. I feel like we should at some point get together with Eric and make him let us do a vlog with him.
The three of us?
What's that?
Are only the three of us still watching it?
I think so. Steve dropped off it.
I don't know what it is about Enigma. I feel really strange about the fact that I like him so much.
It has such production value and such a wonderful sense of style, and it has a lot of good performances, even if the material isn't good, and it is just fascinating. I don't know what it is. I don't know if it knows what it is, but I can't call it. It's completely unpredictable. It entertains me week in and week out. I think it's a terrible show, but maybe it's not a terrible show.
It's terrible, but it's really fun.
But it's really entertaining. Yeah, I can't stop watching it. Yeah. Yeah, I just watched the new one today. And
yeah,
I liked it.
I just watched the new one this morning too.
Yeah, I like it. So I don't know. I wanna get back together with Eric and see if we can get him to let us horn in on his vlog, because I wanna talk about that show some more.
Maybe after the season's over we can do like a discussion.
Maybe we should. Maybe we should do a discussion with Eric. Or maybe if he doesn't want to, just me and you, we can do a discussion on it. That'd be fun.
Okay.
I would, yeah, because like it's my channel, I can still talk about other shows I'm not doing crisis vlogs on. Nobody's gonna stop me.
You can cry if you want to.
That's right. Anyway, okay, so I'll do a rant. My rant is how should I start this? So, when I bring this up, I'm not talking about on the channel. I'm talking about like in my regular everyday life, just going out and getting in my car and driving somewhere. I like to dress up. And I like to look classy. I don't like to always wear a t-shirt and jeans. And so this is why I say I'm not talking about the channel when I say this. Because for the longest time I just wore t-shirts on the channel because I didn't want to look like really pretentious and stuff. Like here's a guy talking about superhero shows, but like he's wearing a suit and tie. And that's why I go for more of kind of a casual look now. But this is kind of how I've always preferred to dress. I really like button-up shirts and I like coats, and it's how I like to dress. We've gotten so casual in society now that I can't dress like this without people commenting on it when I go places.
Okay. Yeah.
And it's just weird. People think I stepped out of another era. And what I'm wearing, minus maybe the hat, but that's another thing that drives me crazy. I feel like you ought to be able to wear a hat. People think it's weird that you wear a hat. I'm dressing modern. I don't feel like I look like I don't walk around with a cane or anything. Like I don't feel like I look like
a bowler hat and cape.
No,
I don't. Those were from the same time period.
Yeah, exactly. No, I mean like I'm not walking out of a silent film. I don't feel like I look like I just came out of the 30s or the 40s. But it never fails. Every time I go somewhere, there's always at least one person and here's the thing, I'm complaining about compliments, and I realize that's awful, but almost always someone will come up to me and they'll be like, and it might be a lot of time it's a perfect stranger. I get it when it's somebody that I know that is used to seeing me wear t-shirts, and it'll be a day that I've dressed up, and they're like, oh, you look nice today. Because, well, yeah, it's not what they're used to, but somebody that doesn't know you, that like I'll walk downtown or I'll go to a movie theater. There was a time where everyone dressed up to go to the movie theater. There was a time where everybody dressed up to go on an airplane. I don't like just how casual we've gotten, or that we've gotten so casual that it's not okay to be a little bit more formal. Like you're stuffy now if you ever wear a button-up shirt. I don't know, like outside of work or something. I don't know. I don't like that. That bugs me. I'll walk downtown somewhere, and I'll just be walking down the sidewalk, and somebody come, oh, you look very dapper today. I mean, like, okay, thanks, but is it that unusual?
That's so weird to me because I like not that you can tell from this, because I honestly make an effort to wear like geeky t-shirts whenever I'm on camera, just because that's the channel that I'm on and that sort of a thing. And also I really love when people recognize my like geeky t-shirts and comment about it.
And that's the thing where like sometimes I want to go back to the t-shirt thing, and I might start alternating again, because like I've got some really cool ones. Sometimes new ones will come out, and I'm like, I really want that, and it's fun to see people comment on those on the channel. And again, yeah. I'm not complaining that people have said, hey, Cap, why do you always wear like a suit or a button-up shirt? Because I didn't used to. I get that, but it's weird in, like, real life with people that don't know you.
Well, but what I was going to say, like, from what you see of me on Geekvolution, you would probably assume that I mostly wear t-shirts all the time. But I actually wear a lot of, like, skirts and, like, in fact, usually when I'm wearing a t-shirt, I am not wearing jeans with that. I'll usually wear a skirt with, like, a t-shirt. And, like, I, even when I'm, like, dressing down, I try to dress up. But, like, I wear a lot of dresses, curl my hair a lot, stuff like that. And I, like... I mean, I'm not like, I don't get compliments, but like, I feel like I don't have that sort of like, oh, well, you look dapper today sort of a thing the way that you do. And well, I don't know if it's maybe because I'm a girl.
That's
and
the
like,
point
it's more
I'm
socially
making.
Socially acceptable yeah, for girls to be wearing dresses.
Exactly. With respect, I think,
well, yeah.
I think this is a guy thing. I like.
I would totally believe it because I like, I've never noticed any sort of difference between when I'm wearing one thing or another. Like I'll get just as many people being like, oh, you look nice today, or like, oh, you look cute today, or like, I like your shirt, or whatever. Whether I'm wearing, like, a geeky t-shirt and my hair's up in a bun, or I'm, like, wearing all this makeup and curled hair and stuff like that, like, I feel like it's pretty similar. So it's interesting that for guys, it's, like, a different social norm, I guess, at
yeah,
that point.
Because the thing is, like, it does seem like in my regular everyday life that most guys are wearing t-shirts and jeans. And like it's like if you're a man and you dress like this, you're trying to stand out.
Hmm.
And my thing is, I'm not trying to stand out, but it happens anyway. And so it's like I feel like I have to purposefully dress way down so that I'm not looking like I'm trying to get attention from people. I don't like that.
Not to, like, make this into any sort of, like, gender thing, but, like, do you notice...
I think it is a gender thing.
Yeah, but, like, do you notice that you get more of those comments from men versus from women? Or, like more of them from, like people that are younger than you or older, you know what I mean? Like, is there any sort of, like, trend?
If I can read into it at all, because it happens, and I'm making it sound like this happens, like, constantly.
he steps out his front door, and people are like, looking very dapper today.
Yeah, well, and to be fair, when I wear t-shirts, I get comments, too, but it's like, that t-shirt's cool.
Yeah.
You know, or I recognize that. That's a different thing. But I stand by what I said a minute ago. If I'm out for any length of time, usually at least one person. I do think it's more women than it is men, if it's people I don't know. But I also tend to... I don't know if this is true. I was going to say... And this is probably regional and, like, where you live. But I also think that I tend to strike up more conversations with women I don't know than men that I don't know. I don't know if that's true, though.
Yeah,
I'm a pretty outgoing, extroverted person, so I strike up conversations with all kinds of different people, but I think that maybe... Sometimes women seem to be slightly more approachable, but I guess it just depends on where I am. I don't know.
But we've also talked about this before, because I have the same thing where I am always more likely to become friends with guys than I am to become
right.
friends with girls.
And then that's just
and
a personality
you have the same
thing.
Where you have always been more likely to be friends with women
that's it.
Than with men, mm-hmm. and... like, that probably has something to do with it, too, just that that's
and,
who you like hanging out with, or whatever,
thing.
Like, that's who is easier for you to become
and also,
friends with.
Stage of your life and stuff, like, these days, I usually have my kids with me, so women walk up to me all the time.
Yeah.
Because I have really
like,
cute,
oh,
kids. And,
cute kids.
Yeah, and so, like, I struck up all kinds of conversations with women, because they think my kids are cute, and they want to talk to my kids. And I have this thing, this is neither here nor there, I have this thing when I'm standing in line for, like, at a restaurant, like, say, at Chipotle or something, that, like, if it's a really long line, because as a lot of you know, I eat a lot of Chipotle. And
me too, Cap, we're on the same page.
Yes,
there.
I know what Lo and I will be doing when I visit her this summer, but, When I'm standing in line for a long time, like you know, Chipotle at, like, you know, 5:30, 6 o'clock often has a line out the door, I don't like to stand next to a person for too long without saying something. I don't know what that is, but, like, it's not always awkward, and sometimes people are just, like, burying their phone or whatever, talking to somebody else, but if I'm with a person for a long time, and, like, we've made eye contact more than twice, I'm going to say something. I almost always feel... So, I'm just a very, like, outgoing social person. I like people. I like to talk to people. But here's the thing. If I can read into this at all, and I might be totally off base, but when it's happened with guys, they seem kind of surprised, where it's like, nobody's ever been mean about it, but it's just like, well, if you didn't have to dress that way, why did you bother?
I mean, I know that I have specifically pointed it out to Steve when he's been wearing, like, really nice.
Well, that's a good point. And you know what? And see, I'm guilty of this too, because I mentioned, I think the thing is, it's not the norm anymore. And yeah. I just don't like that it's, I don't want to say not socially acceptable. People, here's the thing. When it's
not
guys,
normal. It's not the social norm
yes,
anymore.
When it's men, more often than not, especially the people I know, it seems to be, I'm surprised you dressed up because you're not doing anything special today, and that looks uncomfortable. And with women, especially if you're wearing a tie, ties are uncomfortable. Why would you wear a tie? I don't find them uncomfortable. But when, I'm used to them. But when I'm not wearing one right now, but I like ties, I'm used to them. But curiously, when it's women, it seems to more often be, I'm impressed that you spent more than 5 seconds thinking about your wardrobe this morning, because most men don't do that. Like, it seems to be more like that.
Yeah.
Or maybe even with, because I have kids, it's like, oh good, you're setting a good example for your children. You're dressing well.
I mean, I'm probably one of the worst people to talk to about this, because my husband dresses better than me most days, partly because of his job, but also just because...
No, he's a spiffy dresser, that guy.
He's a very spiffy dresser. I was not lying when I said he's like Earth 2 Barry. Like,
yes.
Bow ties and all that sort of stuff all the time.
I would not be surprised to learn that Gabe carries a pocket watch. He seems like a pocket watch guy.
He actually used to. When we were dating in high school, I bought him an engraved pocket watch.
Nailed that! That does not remotely surprise me.
He doesn't anymore, but he has like a really nice wristwatch.
I don't know if that's a remotely valid rant. It's the thing I thought of.
Hey, it's a rant. It works.
Yeah, I can rant about whatever.
You didn't say you have to rant about something valid, just that you have to rant.
I just have to rant about something, yeah. So anyway, there's my odd, somewhat more than personal than usual rant. Everybody, thanks as always for watching. Hope you enjoyed the show. And let us know in the comments what you think about anachronisms, about historical anachronisms in film. And Lo, really interesting topic. Thanks a lot for bringing it to me and for chatting. And also, if there's something you'd like to see us talk about in a future video, leave that in the comments or send me a personal message on Facebook or on Geekvolution. Geekvolution on Facebook or Geekvolution right here. And in the meantime, I'm Captain Logan.
And I'm the Curious Lo, reminding you to support your local comic shops.
See you next time.